is the F-102. Crew, one man. One man in one plane capable of delivering the atomic bomb. America's frontline fighter today. America's frontline fighter in 1918, the SPAD. Speed about 120 miles an hour. Crew, one man, the former leader of the 94th Pursuit Squadron, America's ace of aces in World War I, Captain Eddie Rickenbacker, today chairman of the board of Eastern Airlines.
Those of us who flew this little SPAD in World War I will never forget it. To us, it seemed just as deadly an airplane as the modern jet fighter. It's hard to believe, but we took this plane as high as 20,000 feet and without oxygen. Of course, we knew nothing about electrical heating apparatus or oxygen masks, but we discovered many things about the airplane in World War I. We discovered some of the first principles of air power and combat flying. And those of us who fought in that war came out of it with a pretty clear idea of what the future of flying might be. That's the way the whole aviation history has been. A few men glimpse the future and fly it out. But I've discovered some of the first principles of air power and combat flying. And those of us who fought in that war came out of it with a pretty clear idea of what the future of flying might be. That's the way the whole aviation history has been. A few men glimpse the future and fly it out. Whatever the official and public attitudes may be, this has been true ever since the early days, from the Wright brothers and the beginning of air power.
There were no movie cameras present when the airplane was invented in 1903. Only a few cautious words were printed in the newspapers. The decade before the war was a period of high fashion and conservatism, and the old foundation seemed unshakable. If we marveled at anything, it was the automobile, the earthbound, rattling, clanging, horseless carriage. In 1908, the Army bought an airplane from its inventors, the Wright brothers. Military minds had little idea of how an airplane might be used in war, but the specification said the plane had to fly at 40 miles an hour for 1 hour, in still air, without the use of a gas tank. These are the first films made of an American plane in flight. In 1910, Theodore Roosevelt strapped himself in a Wright Flyer. Teddy was forever shocking the fashionable elements of the country, and he did it again when he became the first United States president to fly. Once Teddy had flown, he said bully and walked away from flying. So did the whole country. In France, novelties are taken more seriously. The president of France, Monsieur Poincaré, visited a flying meet. He saw the Antoinette, the pride of French aviation. Glenn Curtis, an American pioneer of flight, was also present at the French meet. Curtis was the first American to use wheels on an airplane. Nobody was quite sure what an airplane ought to look like or sound like. The Albisard was a two-wing plane with the two wings in a rather unusual position. A French critic called this the most chic airplane in the meet. The Wright brothers' plane was aided in takeoff by a stone weight dropped behind the plane. The French meet was watched by a few military observers who thought perhaps the airplane might have some military value. But to the public, the airplane was only an amusing toy. Its future seemed restricted between danger and novelty. The people who turned out hoped the pilots would break their necks. The pilots were always on the verge of doing so. Toy-like, graceful, this is the Fokker Spider, an early Dutch experiment.
Mm-hmm.
A cyclist of the day, one Monsieur Duchamp, disdained the engine. Any cyclist could fly, providing his legs were strong enough and his wings were long enough. This was another early experiment. You began in the air on a string. You ended in the air on a string. It looked a bit like an airplane, and it flew like a harvesting machine. In those days, the motto was, any landing is a good landing if you can walk away from it. Flight was glory for the gentleman adventurer and the sportsman. Naturally, the fad of flight entered the nightclub. This was called the airplane waltz. The landing, throttle back, gear down, nose high, three-point landing. Pre-war Europe, on the surface, a carnival. Emperor Franz Joseph attended the wedding of the Archduke Karl of Austro-Hungary. So did the Kaiser of Germany and his retinue. But the machine age and mass production of machines had arrived. Mass production sharpened the economic rivalry between European countries. The whole century was rolling in a direction unknown to its armies and to its leaders. Below the surface, intense nationalism. Then suddenly, remotely, the Austrian Archduke assassinated. Austria and Serbia went to war. Russia began to mobilize. Germany mobilized. She declared war, not against anybody, just a state of war. Received a German ultimatum which the French considered an insult to their national honor. The British were allied with the French. Secret alliances, competition for foreign markets, jingoism, all were leading to a world conflict. Each country knew how it would win this new war, just the way the last major war had been won. Quick mobilization, massive infantry, a few cavalry attacks. And so the romantic cavalry, residue of the Victorian age, galloped into the 20th century and was slaughtered by the child of the 20th century, the machine gun. The machine gun, an almost unnoticed weapon, stopped the cavalry, it stopped the infantry, stopped the idea of a short war of movement. romantic, mobile war slowed to a static battle of trench warfare. The orthodox military men were unable to adapt to the change. Believing in infantry, artillery, and the massed bayonet charge, they called for frontal attack after frontal attack. Hear the French in Flanders during the winter of 1914. Watch how neatly their lines advance, and how the exposed troops are cut down by a handful of German machine guns. Neither side ever gained complete control of the seas. The only head-on battle between the fleets of the British and the Germans was at the Battle of Jutland. Battleship capsizes and thousands of men try to swim away from the suction of the sinking ship. As the land war had gone underground, the sea war went underwater. German submarines began unrestricted warfare against merchant ships, attempting to starve the British by blockade. The romance of the sea was drowned by the submarine. Captain Rickenbacker notes the progress of the air war.
The observation balloon was the first aerial weapon. It had been used as early as the American Civil War. The first airplanes were thought of as observation balloons without strings. An early French staff report on aviation asserted, real combat in the air must be considered a myth. The duty of the aviator is to see and not to fight. Nevertheless, early flyers fired pistol shots at each other. Later, hand grenades were thrown. Still later, our observers carried crude bombs in their laps and dropped them. The idea of carrying a machine gun on an airplane also came early in the war, but the planes bounced too much for accurate aiming. A new idea was introduced. The guns were fixed to fire forward, and the planes, instead of the guns, were aimed at the enemy. Until we learned how to synchronize guns and props, some pilots actually shot off their own propellers. The early air war had no rules. We were finding out what the airplane could and couldn't do. When the pilots received incendiary bullets, they went after the hydrogen-filled balloons. Later became traps. Both sides put masses of machine guns around them and waited for the pilots to attack. The airplane was being used to destroy the enemy's ability to observe. This meant that each side tried to deny the air to the other and led to air-to-air combat. We called it dogfighting. We maneuvered to get into the enemy's blind or undefended spots.
pilots went down with them. This is the French chase, George's gear mirror being decorated. Charles Nungus here, later to die attempting a transatlantic crossing. Baron Manfred von Richthofen, with 80 kills, was the leading German ace of the war. Another pilot who flew with Richthofen was Hermann Goering. Goering was later to become the head of the German Air Force in World War II. In some rear areas of the Royal Flying Corps, lady mechanics attracted as much attention as the British aces.
There were no aces in the infantry. There was almost no individual combat. The war had become one slow-moving mass pitted against another. From beginning to end, the whole battle line on the Western Front never moved more than 150 miles. Artillery became more massive. Hundreds of heavy guns covered every mile of the front. And a new weapon was added, gas. German attack at Verdun in 1916 was frontal and direct. No subtlety, no maneuver, mass attacks and mass extermination. Though the pretense of individual bravery lingered, the French were to lose a generation of their youth. The Germans, 6 million casualties. The Austrians, nearly 5 million. The British, 3 million. The Victorian customs lingered while the sons of the Victorians died. Both sides were almost exhausted when the United States entered the war. President Wilson signed the Declaration of War for high purposes. And we went to war with high hopes and slogans. The Yanks are coming. We're going to hang the Kaiser. We're going to make the world safe for democracy. We're sailing to end the war, to end all wars. Lafayette, we are here.
Full of Americans had served with the British Royal Flying Corps and the French Lafayette Escadrille. But those American pilots who came over in 1917 had little training and no planes. Our squadron flew French equipment. We were a group of happy-go-lucky individuals. Here I introduce the members of my squadron to the camera. We called ourselves the Hat in the Ring Squadron.
General Pershing precipitated a crisis. He refused to allow American units to be used as replacements for British and French troops. This army would fight as a unit in an American sector. In boxcars marked 40 men, 8 horses, the Americans moved to the front. As the Americans came closer to the trenches, they shed their slogans with their excess equipment. The cynicism that was beginning to infiltrate all other armies reached the Americans. In September 1918, the United States First Army attacks near San Miguel. The troops are new, but the tactics are old. Over the top, indirect, frontal assault.
There could be no greater. contrast to the ground war than the war in the air. On the ground, massive, slow-moving battles. In the air, lightning attacks and raids. The concepts of cavalry had shifted to the sky. Hit, destroy, and run. The idea of denying the air to the enemy had gone one step further. Instead of meeting him in dogfights, we began to attack his installations and airfields.
Plane probably did not shorten the war by one day. But by 1918, the American infantry had given the Allies numerical superiority. In the early fall of 1918, a final massive push against the Hindenburg line. Tanks provided the first successful answer to the machine gun. Along the Meuse and at the Argonne, in Flanders and along the Somme, the Allies moved ahead. Airplanes to support the attacking ground troops. 1,500 planes of the Allied air forces were engaged in the San Miguel Drive. The German army broke. Became a rout. On November 11th, 1918, at 11 o'clock, an armistice. The war was over. Americans came home, although they had seen only a year of combat, they were cynical. No parade could stem the feeling of anti-militarism that would follow the most unromantic war of modern history. We danced in the streets more because of relief than because of victory. When the Allied leaders met at Versailles, they drew up an unworkable treaty. Led by the isolationists, the American Congress rejected both the Treaty of Versailles and the League of Nations. America withdrew behind its ocean. We felt we had been betrayed. The only adventure, the only incident that captured the public's imagination, the airplane. The only folklore and legend to emerge from battle, the whirling, swirling, individual combat in the sky. Plane to the jet fighter, an incredible advance. But to all men who fly alone in the sky, there is always a new frontier, a continuing adventure.